Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel, I'm Joe. The ideas of inheritance can be very useful and applicable in game development. We can use Let's Code to write the child class behave as we want them, because we will reuse the code from the base class. In this video, we will first make one base class called Enemy. All of the enemies will have the same behaviors. Then, we will use inheritance features to override specified function. Each enemy will have their unique behavior. Some of them inherit from the base class, while others get rid of the base class functions and have their unique behaviors. Finally, three of enemies have different behaviors, and we will understand why inheritance can save you a great amount of time in creating characters. As always, the link for the project repository is on the description below. You can download the starting project on my Google Drive. Also, all of the tips you can find on my GitHub. Okay, let's get into it. First, let's look at how the character's movement is achieved. We have set the gravity skills variable to 0, so that the player is not affected by gravity. And under constraints, we have set freeze rotation on the Z or Z axis to true. This will prevent the player game object from rotating in world space. Also, we have added one box collider 2D component to handle physical collisions for our player. We use animator component to assign animation to our player game object in the scene. Inside player movement script, we have one public float variable called moveSpeed. This controls how fast the character moves. We are capturing input from the input system into two float variables called moveH and moveV. Next, we will multiply it by the float variables moveSpeed, which we can control from the inspector. I use rigidbody.velocity quite often. We just set the velocity as equals to the new vector 2, moveH and moveV. Back to Unity, we already have one dungeon environment by using tailmap2D system. For each enemy, there are sprite render, animator, and rigidbody2D component. And each enemy game object, we have one UI canvas group. The canvas render mode is world space. In this render mode, the cameras will behave as any other objects in the scene. We use UI text and UI image to display their names and health bars. We have two waypoint game objects in our hierarchy. The bat enemy will patrol between these two points. As always, I have created several folders in order to manage the assets easily. Go to script folder. Let's create one folder called enemy. Inside this folder, create one C# script called enemy. Inside the enemy script, we need to declare enemy name, enemy move speed, and their health point. I use serialized field private because we want to check this private variable's value on inspector. You can easily change the value like public variable, but no one can access this value from another script or places. The third private is a float number that is called health point. So, this float number will actually track down how many health points do we left until we dead. And we have another float variable that is called max health point. Also, really straightforward, when the game starts, our health point variable's value will be equal to the max health point value. Create one function called introduction. We can put debug.log to get all of the information from the enemy in our game. Call this function inside the stars function. Save the script and switch back. We can select all of the enemy game objects. Add the enemy script. Now we can easily change the value on inspector. Then press play. We will receive the correct messages on console window. However, it's not looking very correct on the health point value because we forgot to assign the max health point value to the health point value inside the start function. Test again. Now, all of the information will be displayed correctly. We want each of the enemy can follow our player. We declare one transform type variable called target. We know that this target variable is our player's transform component. Create one function called move. transform.position is equal to the vector2.moveTowards. We want our enemy move towards the target location in each frame. There are three parameters on here. The first one is our current position. The second one is our target position. The third one is our move speed multiplied by the time.deltaTime. So how do we get access of our target? We use findGameObject with tag to get access of our player game object. Don't forget to get component of the transform type as well. The player tags must be declared in Tag Manager before using it. After that, press play. Our enemies can follow the player. Then, we can set the attack range for our enemies. If the player is inside this attack range, our enemy will follow the player. Otherwise, they will do nothing. We have another private variable that is called distance. If the distance between player and this enemy is less than the range value, enemy start to follow our player. Back to Unity, we want our slam always follow the players so that we can set this value to a huge number, such as 99. The range of bat, I want to set value to 4. Another value in which I set to 3. When we press play, you will notice that the bat always follow us when the game starts. If our player close to the bat start following us as well. Once we leave this range, the bat will stop following us and stay alone. Cool. Also, we quickly create one function to make our enemies look more nature when they follow our player. Declare one sprite render type variable called SP. If this enemy is on the right side of our player, the sprite render.flipX will turn into true. Otherwise, the flipX will turn into false. SpriteRender.FlipX can flip the sprite on the x-axis. Call this function inside the update. When we press play, we can check whether enemies turn their directions according to the player position or not. Oops, something wrong here because I forgot to get access of the SpriteRender component inside the start function. Press play. Nice. Now we want the slam move as normal. However, the bat can patrol between two points. When the player close to the bat start to follow him. Also, we don't want the witch follow our player. We want her flash on the map and move randomly. The witch can shoot our player by using projectile. Another two enemies will attack the player when they touch to him. Honestly, we can simply create three independent scripts to describe their behaviors. However, if we have a bunch of enemies and almost enemies have the common function, the ideas of inheritance can be very useful in game development. We might, for example, have a class called characters. This class covers all of the things that characters should do in our game, such as the character speak, character move, and character attacked. We then have two classes, enemy and player, which inherit from the class character. Then these two classes, player and enemy, would also have three functions, speak, move, and attack. They can inherit all of the character classes member and properties. We will then have two more child classes of players, wizard and dragon warrior. These already behave like players, which in turn behave like character. In this way, we have much less code to write to make Dragon Warrior and the Wizard behave as we want them to, because we are reusing the code from character and player. By the way, when talking about inheritance, the class that is being inherited from is called the parent or base class. The class that is inheriting is called the child or derived class. Create three C# script called slam Bat, and Witch. Select these three game objects and get rid of the enemy script. Then drag the new script to their inspector. By default, scripts made in Unity follow this format. Public class followed by the name of the class, followed by a colon and the class name mono behavior. The colon in class name mono behavior is telling the script that it inherits from mono behavior. To make this class inherit from another class, simply change the name mono behavior to some other's class name. You might wonder why our scripts inherit from mono behavior. Items like game objects, transform, the stuff methods, the update methods, and more all come from mono behavior. Our script inherit from mono behavior so that we have access to these features. We want the Slime class inherit from the enemy class. We can delete the mono behavior and type enemy. The result of inheritance is that items that exist in the parent class will also be available in the child class. Therefore, methods and variables can be used in the child class as if it was the parent class. You will notice that we can get access of the variables from base class, and this variable display on inspector. When we press play, the Slime behave looks like before, even we did not type anything else inside the Slime script. Slime class inherit from the enemy class. In other words, the Slime class can inherit all of the enemy's class members and properties. If you don't want to display this message inside the console window, what should we do? To override this function, we need to type override void introduction. You will notice that the editor do not offer the option override introduction function. We can bind to base class. Try to change the private access modifier to public. We still cannot get this option. To override this function, first we have to make it virtual, and you simply type the virtual keyword here and use the protected access modifier. The protected access modifier acts as a hybrid between public and private. All features of the parent class that are protected will exist and be accessible in a child class, like public features, but will not be accessible outside the parent or child classes, like private features. And now, if you go to the Slime class, you can see when I type override void, it already offers me the option override the introduction function. And this here, what base means exactly using the behavior from the base class, the class we inherit from. So base.introduction means they will call the introduction from the base class. For this case, if you want to display the previous message, you can choose to keep this line. Otherwise, if you delete this line, no messages will be sent on console window. If you want to give up the previous messages and override a new messages, you can port debug log to edit a new one. The same step to override another function. If we want to override the move function in base class, first we have to mark move function with virtual to override it in child class. We replace the private access modifier with protected because we still want this function be accessible inside this class or child class. We keep the move function alone. Now we can also change the bat and witch introduction function. We keep the base.introduction inside the witch script. When you press play, there are two new messages on console window, and which still display the previous information. Let's edit the enemy on inspector first. Now the bat can inherit the move function from the base class. Also, we decide to add more features for his move behavior. The bat should patrol between two waypoints. When the player close to him, bat start to follow us. Otherwise, if the player is far away from his attack range, bat will keep patrolling again. So we have two public variables called waypoint1 and waypoint2. And we have another private transform variable that is called waypointTarget. The waypointTarget will actually track down which waypoint is our bat target currently. At the beginning of the game, we set the waypointTarget to waypoint1. We keep the base.move because we want to keep this function and add more features inside here. If the distance between the bat and the player is greater than, you will notice that we cannot get access of the target variable because the target variable is declared as private in base class. We can simply replace private access modifier with public to get access of these variables in child class. Also, we can keep the private access modifier alone and add the protected which we have talked about before. If the distance between bat and the player is greater than the range, we want our bat patrol between two points. If the distance between bat and waypoint 1 is less than 0.01, which means the bat almost reached to this point, bat has to change his target to the waypoint 2. If the distance between bat and waypoint 2 is less than 0.01, which means our bats have to come back to waypoint 1 again and again. Finally, we can also use vector2.moveTowards. First parameter is our current bat position. Second parameter is the waypoint target position. The third parameter is the move speed multiplied by time.deltaTime. If you can't get access the move speed from the base class, don't forget to check the access modify, making sure it should be the public or protected private access modify. Save the script and switch back. Drag the waypoints to the inspector. When we press play, the bat will patrol between these two points. Once our player close to his range, the bat will follow us. If our player move fast and keep the distance with him, he will patrol these two points again. Nice! We can try to delete this line. The bat will definitely not follow us. If the player close to the bat, he will stay alone and do nothing. Because we have override the move function and get rid of the previous move function features in base class. Now let's keep the base.move line here. If you want the witch follow the player, you can type base.move. If we want the witch flash randomly on the map, we can delete the base.move and override a new function. We create a new function called RandomMove. We want our witch can move randomly in each 2 seconds. We use one private variable called MoveTimer to achieve. Inside the RandomMove function, MoveTimer always increases according to the time.deltaTime. If the MoveTimer is greater to the sequences of the move, if the move timer is greater than 2, we want to reset the move timer. Also, we want to randomize this current position. Since we want the witch appear inside the dungeon, we declare 4 variables to record the maximum and minimum size of this environment. Bend to Unity and find the maximum and minimum XY values of this map. Press play. Now our witch can move randomly instead of following us like Slam and Bat. Great. Now we want to add more features inside the base class. We create 2 protective virtual functions called attack and death. We can put debug.log inside the attack function. If our enemy dead, we want the enemy destroy himself. Inside the update function, if the health point we have declared before is less than 0, we will call the death function. Call the attack function inside the update as well. Once the bat or slam touch to player, our player will hurt, so they don't need any special attack function. Instead, we want the witch shoot to our player. Go to witch script, we want our witch shoot in each 2 seconds. Declare one private variable called shoot timer. And we declare one game object type variables called projectile. I have pre-made the projectile and make it as prefab. Override the attack function. Instantiate the projectile game object in each 2 seconds. Drag the projectile prefab to the inspector. This is our projectile prefab. The gravity scales is set to 0. Also, we need one circle collide 2D component to achieve this script. Here is the projectile script. The projectile always follows the players. After 2 seconds later, the projectile will destroy himself, even if it did not touch to the player. If you are curious about this script, you can pause the video and take a look. Also, don't forget to keep the short timer always increased inside the attack function. Now, our witch can shoot in each 2 seconds and move randomly. If it's not looking very natural yet, you can change the shoot rate to 2.1. Finally, we want our player attack the enemies and each enemy will display their correct UI health point images during gameplay. We can simply use import.getKeyDump keycode.space to simulate our player attack. Once we press the spacebar, the enemy's health point will decrease 10 points. However, their UI health bar still did not change dynamically. First, let's declare their UI image using unitengine.ui. One image type variable that is called health point image. This variable represents our current health point UI image. The second image type variable represents the health point decreasing effect. We create a new function called displayHPBar and call this function inside the update. Our HPImage.FillAmount is equal to the current health point value divided by the max health point value. Making sure your UI image, UI type, is filled. A filled image will display a section of the sprite. The image.fillAmount will determine how much of the image to show. You can simply drag the slider of fillAmount to check the result. If the field amount of the health point effect is greater than the field amount of the current health point, we want the health point effect decrease until these two variables have the same value. So we can go ahead and fill this stuff in. Press play. Nice, everything looks perfect. We have shared display HP bar, death, and turn direction function in base class. We have also overrided the introduction, move, and attack function in the child class. In this tutorial, I'm intending to avoid another keyword called abstract. We will talk this abstract keyword later. As we can see, we can simply write 3 independent scripts for slam, bat, and witch. Also, we can choose to reuse the code from base class enemy, and use less code to write different get objects. Imagine if we have more than 10 characters, using inheritance will save you a great amount of time in creating characters. Also, there are many other methods to solve this kind of problems. Inheritance is one of the most efficient ways to deal with it. As always, the link for the project access is on the description below. If you have anything you would like to see being made on a video, let me know in the comments. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like it, share with friends, and subscribe to my channel. There's much more to come. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video.